pure and white linen, representing the righteousness of God, and then having their breasts girded with golden girdles, representing the faith of the believing remnant coming through the tribulation period as gold. I don't think this shows, I mean, it certainly doesn't mean the angels were tried and they had gold works, because they're just created beings. They're treated differently than humans are. But I think it's just a sign of Israel. It's the offer of righteousness, the pure and white linen, and then they accept it by believing in God's law covenant to bring them through. That's the gold, the golden girdles there. Now verse 7 says, one of the four beasts gave unto the seven angels seven golden vials full of the wrath of God who liveth forever and ever. Go back to chapter 5. A little bit about these golden vials. The golden vials are full of the wrath of God. In Revelation 5, the golden vials are full of something different. Chapter 5, verse 8 says, when he had taken the book, the four beasts and 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of saints. So first we've got these golden vials full of the prayers of saints. Now Revelation 6 verse 9 is going to tell us what those prayers are. Revelation 6 verse 9, you've got the believing remnant of Israel who are martyred because of their faith. Here in verse 9 it says, when he had opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held. And they cried with a loud voice, saying, how long, O Lord, holy and true, dost thou not judge and avenge our blood on them that dwell on the earth? That's their prayer. It doesn't specifically say prayer, but if you go to the Lord and you petition him for something, for, you know, when are you going to avenge our blood, you know, that's a prayer. So we're told at first that these golden vials are full of the prayers of saints from chapter 5, verse 8. Chapter 6, verse 10 tells us the prayers of the saints is for their blood to be avenged for them, because they were, the justice of God would require that innocent people, their blood be avenged. They were killed for having faith in God, so God declares them as holy, but yet they're killed. So God has to avenge them. So then we go to chapter 15 and verse 7. And it says, one of the four beasts gave unto the seven angels seven golden vials full of the wrath of God who liveth forever and ever. So when we put all three verses together, what I think we're seeing is you have the prayers of the saints asking for God's justice for destroying the wicked. And then you have God then answering those prayers by filling it with the wrath of God. So the seven vials, really in chapter 16, we're going to see are all these judgments leading up to the end of the tribulation period, with Babylonian falling, with the mountains being removed, the islands fleeing away, that type of thing. All that is really an answer by God to the prayers of the saints for him to avenge their blood upon the earth. For them, you know, the injustice of innocent people who had faith in God being killed by the wicked. So that's what those golden vials are there. So you're filling the blank. It's in chapter 5, verse 8, says that the golden vials contain the prayers of the saints. Those prayers are for God's judgment of the wicked. Those prayers are for God's judgment of the wicked. And so, then I wanted to conclude today with verse 8. And I wanted you to notice here in verse 8, it says, the temple was filled with smoke from the glory of God and from his power. And no man was able to enter into the temple till the seven plagues of the seven angels were fulfilled. Several times in Scripture we're told about the temple being filled with smoke from the glory of God. This is the only time... I'm fine. This is the only time in which we're told that the temple is also filled not just by the glory of God, but also from his power. I think that's significant because I think a lot of times we look at it and we know, you know, the chart up here, you know what God's doing, that he's going to redeem us, give us eternal life. He's going to destroy the wicked. He's going to cast those who are the unbelievers into the lake of fire. But if Christ never died on the cross, wasn't buried, and rose from the dead, if this event never happened, then eternal life in heavenly places for us, the body of Christ, eternal life for Israel in the kingdom, death in the lake of fire for all unbelievers, for all dispensations, all those things could never happen without the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. I think we miss that a lot of times. And that's why it says, from His power here. I wrote on your outline that God's power comes from conquering death and Satan. Look back in chapter 5. Revelation chapter 5. It's important that we understand this, and I don't think, you know, the vast majority of Christians really don't think about this. They just take for granted what they've heard, but you know, God's power really comes through the cross and the resurrection. Chapter 5, verse 1, I saw on the right hand of him that sat on the throne a book written within and on the back side sealed with seven seals. So this here are the beginning of the events of the tribulation period. Verse 2, I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof? Verse 3, and no man in heaven nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. You know, we look at God as all-powerful, all-knowing, and He is that. But we also, one thing I think people miss is that God is also a just God. There are rules that He's established in the world and by which it operates. He cannot go against those rules. You know, people say, well, God can do anything. Well, there are some things He can't do. He can't take an unbeliever who refuses to believe, you know, today in the blood of Christ and give him eternal life in heaven. As much as He wants to, because He wants all men to be saved. You know, 1 Timothy 2:4 says God wants all men to be saved. But yet, most people are not going to be saved. Most people will end up in the lake of fire. The reason is because even though God has the power to bring everybody into His kingdom for all eternity, the justice of God requires that unless the blood of Christ has been applied to pay for their sins, they have to be thrown in the lake of fire. And if they don't have faith in that blood today, it doesn't matter how God's justice keeps him from taking His power to bring them into heaven. He has to. The justice of God requires him to put them into the lake of fire. So when we look at this world, when Adam and Eve ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, they fell. The dominion that they had was given back over to Satan. 2 Corinthians 4 says that Satan is the god of this world. As the god of this world, he has every right to keep people here. It's sort of like, you think of the illustration, let's say if, let's say I went over to Germany and I robbed a bank. The United States, so then Germany punishes me, they put me in jail. The United States could say, well, he's our citizen, take him out of jail, bring him over here. We're going to make him president of the United States. You know, well, that's kind of morals we have for presidents, but anyway, say, so we're going to make him president. Germany says, well, you can't do that. He's under our jurisdiction. You say, well, he's our citizen. Well, it doesn't matter where I came from. If I'm in Germany and I rob a bank there, I'm subject to the punishments of that law. So you can think of that for us today in the earth. We're on this earth. God can't come along and say, I'm all powerful. Every single person who's ever lived is going to spend eternity with me. Satan says, you can't do that. I'm the god of this world. I have power over the earth and everybody that's in the earth here. You have to, in other words, the only way that he can give eternal life and bring them from Satan's kingdom into God's kingdom is if he conquers the enemy, if he conquers Satan. And so that's what he did with the cross. So when we look in chapter 5 of Revelation, even though he's God and he's all-powerful, he can't say, I'm God, I'm going to bring out the tribulation, and I'm going to destroy the wicked, and I'm going to bring the believers into heaven with me, or I'm going to bring them into the kingdom on earth. Without the power to back that up, he can't do it. And so so that's why when this tribulation starts, it's not God as powerful God doing it. It's that the justice of God requires that a perfect man be the one who brings the punishment upon them. That's why it says in verse 3, Revelation 5, 3, no man in heaven nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. In other words, the justice of God requires a man who is worthy to bring about that punishment. Someone who is above the punishment. A man above the punishment to inflict that punishment upon man. And he says no one's worthy. So verse 4, John weeps because he says, well, it says verse 4, I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. Because John realizes if there is no power here, if the justice of God requires a perfect man to bring about the judgment, and there's no perfect man to fit the bill that can bring that judgment, that means John and everybody else who has ever lived in all dispensations will forever be subject to Satan and under Satan's control, because there's no power to overthrow Satan. Man gave the power to Satan in the garden. It's up to man then to overcome Satan and bring the power back to God. Of course, the good news is, verse 5, one of the elders saith unto me, weep not, behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof. Through Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection, when God raised him from the dead, 1 Corinthians 15 tells us, thanks be to God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ, referring to that victory over death. And so it's important that we recognize that when it comes to the tribulation events, the destruction of the wicked, eternal life for us in heavenly places, eternal life for Israel in the kingdom, all of that is only possible through the perfect man, the Lord Jesus Christ, conquering death and Satan. So we read those verses earlier where he spoiled principalities and powers, made an open show of them. Ephesians 1 talks about that God has placed him over far above all principality and power. We read Psalm 2 that because he was made the son, he is entitled to the inheritance of the Gentiles. All that together tells us, and we're out of time, or else we'd go through all those verses and read them in detail. But it tells us that the power that we see in Revelation 15 in the temple, before we only saw God's glory, the power to bring about death to the wicked and eternal life for those who have faith in what God has told them, only comes through the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. That's why in Exodus and in 2 Chronicles and different places where the glory of the Lord fills the temple, it only says the glory of the Lord. But here in Revelation 15, verse 8, the temple is filled with smoke from the glory of God and from His power. His power comes about through Jesus, and that is what makes it possible for God to overthrow Satan, cast him into the bottomless pit, throw the false prophet and the Antichrist into the lake of fire, and then after the millennial reign, take Satan, throw him in the lake of fire, then have Jesus Christ sit on that great white throne judgment and judge all unbelievers to the lake of fire. That's what makes it possible for him to raise us to be seated with Christ in heavenly places today in the dispensation of grace. That's what makes it possible for him to take believe in Israel and set him in that kingdom, be with him forever. That's what makes it possible for the Gentiles in Israel's program to be blessed and be in that eternal kingdom forever, being blessed in Israel. All of that takes place through the cross of Christ, the death, burial, and resurrection. I know we're way over, but I did want to cover that. And look, let's close with this one verse, if I can find it. 1 Timothy 6. I think this sums it up perfectly. 1 Timothy 6, verse 14 through 16. 1 Timothy 6, verse 14. Paul charges Timothy, he says, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ. So it's a reference to Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he shall show who is the blessed and only potentate. Potentate is a reference to the power. You know, if something is potent, it's powerful. He is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and Lord of lords, who only hath immortality, dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto, whom no man has seen nor can see, to whom be honor and power everlasting. Amen. So we'll close with that, but I just wanted you to see, and what most people lose sight of, is that without the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, there is no power for God to bring about all these events, the tribulation period, the kingdom, us in heavenly places, unbelievers in lake of fire. That only takes place by God's power, and that's only through the cross work of Christ. Let's close with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the cross of Christ, what he did there, but he didn't have to stay on that cross. But the justice of God, as a perfect man, raised him from the dead. We thank you that we've been placed into his death, burial, and resurrection so that we have eternal life with him in Christ. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, y'all.